to this live session of the Gerhard Center, the center that focuses from Cairo, Egypt, on philanthropy, civic engagement, and responsible business. Overall, a very strong focus on social change in the Arab region, and particularly empowering young people, the youth of the Middle East, with leadership and civic engagement skills. Today we have with us Mr. Rajkumar from the fame of the DevEx. He's a founding member, he's the president, he's the editor-in-chief of a really important media platform. Anybody who works in development, like I and many of my colleagues in the United Nations with the European Union, and wherever you talk about aid agencies, we're all looking at DevEx, the opinions that are coming out there. DevEx in itself is a social enterprise, so Mr. Rajkumar is not just an editor, but he is a social entrepreneur himself and has by now built a global network of people who provide content. DevEx's mission is to do good and to do it well. And therefore, we are extremely interested to hear the reflections that he would offer. I think you recently published, Mr. Kumar, on the business of changing the world. You recently published on global health and the 7 predictions for 2021. So I think we're all eager to hear from you. Over to you.
Well, thank you so much, Richard. And, you know, as we were getting started today, you and myself and Ali Aouni were speaking. And of course, he has a beautiful library behind him. I have just one book strategically placed for all of you to see, which is this book that that I'm here to talk about today, The Business of Changing the World. And I think you gave a great introduction, Richard, because the issues that I try to tackle in that book are very aligned, I think, with this speaker series. I do address philanthropy. I do address social innovation, social enterprise, and kind of the changing nature of the aid industry, as we might call it. And in fact, when I was working on the book and talking to publishers, we were wrestling with what do we even call this space, this area of social impact or global impact, the area that the sustainable development goals are targeting. And the fact that we don't really have the words yet, we don't have the language yet, I think shows you how transitional this moment is that we're in. And so we ended up using language like the aid industry, right? That's kind of old language. And one of my hopes is that the transformation and disruption happening in this space will lead us to new language that's much more inclusive. It's much less top-down. It's much more about sustainable models and markets. And I think we're heading there. And that's what I'll just talk a little bit about here to kind of get us going. And I'm looking forward to hearing your questions and comments. And hopefully we can have a really dynamic session today. So I'll just tell you 2 quick stories that are in my book. One is about a company that was founded by a young man named Jahil Oliver. Like a lot of people, and I think there's many students and academicians on this call, you know, he did his MBA and he got a job at a bank. And he felt like, what am I doing with my life? I want to do something that has more of an impact in the world. And he was familiar with the enormous challenges around agricultural productivity in low-income countries. You know, for those of you who are from lower-income countries or travel there, it's not uncommon to see farmers working their fields using, you know, old equipment, using a wooden hoe. That equipment's been around for thousands of years, right? The tractor that we're all used to in many advanced economies here where I live in the US, it's not a luxury item. It's an item many homeowners have to trim their own garden. The tractor is more than 130 years old or so. But it's still a luxury item for many people in the world. So this young man, Jahil Oliver, he thought, if I can take the same technological advancements that are coming to ride sharing, companies like Uber or Didi, if I can bring that to tractors, I might serve a whole different audience of people. And I can look at farmers in low-income countries as part of the solution to addressing extreme poverty. And so he did that. He created this concept. He went out and looked for financing. He got some small amounts of financing. He was able to prove that the concept could work. He got some larger amounts. He showed some product market fit. He got even more. And eventually it turned into a real business. It's called Hello Tractor. 75% of the new tractors in Nigeria use Hello Tractor technology. They're now in 5 countries in the continent of Africa. And really what they do is they allow farmers to share access like you would with a ride sharing app to a tractor. And it used to take 40 days of work to plant, prepare a field for harvest. and or for planting, and now it takes 8 hours with a tractor. So a pretty fundamental transformation. The technology at the core of it, the tractor, is old. It's been around a long, long time. But what was needed was a transformation in this aid industry that I mentioned, in the way that we think about social good, in the way that we address it and fund it. And that transformation has led to this major change. You know, the way we might have done this before was to say, you know, millions of people don't have access to a tractor. We need to build a huge project. We need to do a lot of research, and we need to maybe purchase tractors overseas and ship them in to the countries that need them. We might have tried to build some large-scale, multi-year project that may not have been sustainable. I'll give you another example, which isn't a business, but just I think starts to tell us the sort of direction I think this aid industry is moving, and what I call new aid in my book. Many of us, I bet, on this call have been in a taxi or a bus or a minibus. In East Africa, they're called matatus, where you feel like the driver is just crazy, careening down the road at unsafe speeds. You're in the back and you're kind of, you know, praying for your life and thinking, what do I do? Well, if you look at road accidents in many countries in the world, they're a major killer, including of young people. In sub-Saharan Africa, the first or second killer of young people is road accidents. And so a couple of researchers thought, is there some way we can test a way to address this issue very directly and inexpensively? And they came up with this concept called Zusha, which in Kiswahili, I understand, means something like protest or speak up. And they basically put stickers inside the minibuses that said, you know, you can speak up if the driver is driving unsafely, you know, say something. And it created sort of social permission for people to talk. And they bought some billboards, and they did some, you know, basic randomized studies to see, does this make a difference? And they found a 60% reduction in traffic accidents, simply based on a sticker. And so this idea that, you know, we want to save lives from road accidents, from car accidents. How do we do this? Well, maybe we need to fix the roads. Maybe we need better vehicles. Maybe we need training of drivers. You can imagine a very large scale project-based kind of approach to solving this issue. But in the end, it was stickers, very inexpensive, using a basic research methodology that they proved can work. And it's now expanded to multiple countries in the region. It's not a panacea. There is none. We know that when we think about social challenges in the world, there's no silver bullet. But there is a new way of thinking about addressing these challenges that starts with the people in need themselves being at the center of the solution, not just seeing people as victims, but saying, how do we empower people? I think of them as neighbors or partners or consumers, people who are really agents of their own change in their own life. And this new way of thinking is really starting to transform the whole way our industry works. So the basic thesis that I'm here to present to all of you today, that's the core of my book, is that we are experiencing a fundamental industry transformation. We're very used to talking about this in other more commercial industries, right? We can think about automobiles and say Tesla is going to, you know, fundamentally transform every car company in the world. They're all going to become electric and maybe autonomous. Or we can think about the news industry that I'm in and say, you know, Facebook and other internet platforms have just destroyed the business model for many newspapers, have gone out of business completely, and others have had to really change the way they work. I think we're not as used to thinking about work in the social sector, in philanthropy and nonprofits and government aid programs, and thinking of it in terms of industry disruption. But my argument is that we are experiencing that ourselves. And there are a few factors behind that I'll just go into a bit here, and then again, we can get into a conversation. A big one is that for most of the history of what we know of as the aid industry, basically the money that was funding NGOs, that was funding development projects, was coming from just a few rich countries. We're used to a lot of acronyms, a lot of UN agency acronyms, a lot of project acronyms, NGO acronyms. But if you actually see where the money comes to fund those things, it was just a few of the richest countries in the world that were funding 80% of the aid. That has started to shift in two important ways. Now there are many more countries that are major donors. China is the big obvious example, but they're not the only one. India, Turkey, both are major donors. South Korea, Australia. You have many more donor countries in the world now. And then private giving, especially among billionaire philanthropists, but also private sector companies now engaged in these blended business models, have really come on the scene, where probably today a majority of what we would call development aid is coming from private actors, not public actors. So there's been a huge shift from a pretty closed system to an open competition, a more open market. The second big shift is that this was an industry that was largely designed around projects. Again, partly because the money was coming from government, and that's how government procurement and grants typically work. They're worked along the lines of a project. There's a budget, there's a timeline. If you are working in this field and you meet up with friends somewhere, usually the question people say, what project are you working on now? And you hear about the latest project, the latest country you're going to go to for a few years, the latest project you're going to work on. Projects are that unit of activity. This is sort of how we measure what we do in the development sector. And I think that is shifting with the two examples I gave from projects to sustainable business models. These don't have to be for profit, but they have to be more like market mechanisms that have long-term sustainability, where the people involved are seen as customers. They're seen as key to the solution. In that Zusha example I gave, the passenger in the van isn't just someone you're trying to help. It's someone who actually is helping themselves. You're giving them some social permission to speak up, but they're the ones speaking up, right? So it's a different conception from a project to an ongoing sustainable model. I think that's the second really big shift. And then I'd say the third big shift is that as this industry becomes more private sector oriented, more business oriented, we're moving from maybe an economics approach to development, a pure economics approach that sort of looked at poverty and different levels of wealth in the world and said, well, this is a resource problem. We need to move resources from one group to another. This is fundamentally about economics. To another way of thinking, which is, well, economics are obviously very important in this, but we should also think about behavioral sciences, that we're not talking about widgets here, we're talking about people. And we need to think about human-centered design. We need to think about approaches that bring people into the solution. And behavioral science is becoming much more important. It's a word maybe not commonly used in business. Maybe business people would say marketing, but it's a very similar concept. And it's becoming part and parcel of new models of doing development work and trying to achieve social impact. So in sum, there are these three big shifts, I think, transforming our sector. We're moving from a period of kind of monopoly or monopsony power, a few buyers of aid services, to an open market, from a project orientation to a more systemic business model kind of orientation. And then from a very narrow view about poverty to a broader one that thinks about justice, rights, behavioral science, that thinks about people as customers. And I think that these three big trends are pushing us into a very different era in the aid industry, into trying to achieve the sustainable development goals. For those of us who've been in this field for a while, I think the future is going to look very different and feel very different from the way we used to work just a decade ago. And part of the reason I wrote this book, and I'll just end on this point, is that when we started DevEx, I was a graduate student in the government school at Harvard. And I was thinking, like, how do we address the basic challenges in this aid sector, make it more efficient? And I thought, this is the moment that everything is going to shift. The internet was just becoming popularized. This was 1999, 2000, and lots of big industries were being completely disrupted. And I thought, well, development is going to be disrupted too. This area of philanthropy and social change is going to be disrupted. And basically, I was wrong. As I got to know the space better and see how the shifts and trends were happening, I realized, actually, our field wasn't really moving much. It was changing iteratively, but it wasn't fundamentally transforming. And having watched it now for two decades, I've come to the conclusion that now it is actually transforming. The thing I expected two decades ago is actually happening now. And you can see examples all around us. And that creates a real opportunity. If you want to address the biggest challenges in the world today, climate change, poverty, if you want to achieve the sustainable development goals, I think the only way to do it is to take the industry designed to work on these issues and make sure it's fit for purpose, make sure it's designed to be successful. And that means we have to take a hard look at how have we organized ourselves? Do we have real accountability? Do the actors and players in the space actually have accountability against results? And I think there's a chance to really drive forward a results revolution in our field and become much more oriented toward those end consumers, those end users, to think of them as a core to the solution and to follow what works and to hold accountable what doesn't. And that's really what I'm hoping that we can spark with my book, is a conversation about how to get there. So let me pause there. I think I've spoken for my kind of initial 15 minutes, Richard. I'd love to hear your thoughts, your feedback, and again, any questions from others. I'd love to engage with all of you.
Thank you. Thank you, Raj. That was a very, very exciting opening to what we hope will be a good discussion. I first would like to make sure that I invite all the participants to come forward with questions, either stick up your hand and we'll try to give you the word, or try to come in on the chat and we will then subsequently read out the question that you would have. But to kick off the discussion, Raj, you basically say, okay, we're looking here ultimately at a revolution that will bring forward better results for people. But before that, just before that, you were talking about that you'd actually expected this transformation already to happen 20 years ago. So it's now upon us. Let's say it's something of the last, I would say, 3-4 years that it's become increasingly more apparent. Why did it happen now? Why didn't it happen 20 years ago?
Yeah, I speculate in the book a few reasons why I think it's happening now and it didn't happen then. I think probably the biggest one is the rise in private sector funding and the rise in more governments that are major donors in the space. This field was, you know, the economics term when you have a single buyer is a monopsony, right? One group that's buying everything. And you can imagine if, you know, there's one person buying all the houses in the world, you know, that person's going to have a very distinct view about what is a good house design. And pretty soon all the houses will probably match the way that that person thinks they should. Well, we had what was called a monopsony or an oligopsony, a few buyers of all of the aid services you can think of. And those buyers did a lot of great things. They achieved enormous success in the early decades of this aid industry. Many great advancements, for example, in human health. But where the government approach and having just a few buyers fell down is I think they became much more risk averse, much more focused on ensuring that the taxpayers of their country, whether it's the Netherlands or the US, that their taxpayers feel like nothing was wasted, that they can justify everything they do. And so that risk aversion, I think, led to a lack of competition, a lack of innovation, a lack of new ideas. And I think probably the biggest reason it's now and not 20 years ago is that, yes, there are many other factors. Technology's advanced a lot. It's cheap and easy to communicate with end users wherever they live in the world. But a big part of the issue, I think, is just the buyers of these services have dramatically changed and have a different view about what's what they expect to see. Not just risk aversion, not just don't waste a penny, but actually achieve results.
Thank you. I would like to go over now to Salah Eddin, who has put up his finger or his hand rather on the chat. Salah Eddin, you've got the word.
Thank you. My name is Salah. I'm a student at AUC. My question is, you have mentioned seeing people as customers. And my question is, how can we look at them like this if we are talking about philanthropy? And so, yes, that's it. Thank you.
Right. We have this, I think what the economists would call an agency problem in the field of philanthropy or development, which is the people making the decision might be sitting in London, but the person that they're trying to affect might be someone who's living below the extreme poverty line, earning $1 a day, perhaps in a very low income country, somewhere across the world. So whose voice do we listen to here? And the reality is that the philanthropist is trying to say, I know what's best. I can figure out the best solution for this poor person. And so, you know, I'm going to spend the money in this way. And the problem with that approach, if our mindset is that, you know, we're going to really listen to the people who hold the purse strings, they may be very distant from the people who are actually affected, who are probably much closer to understanding what's needed in their lives. And one of the examples I give in my book is called Give Directly. I don't know if Salah, if you've heard of them, but the name kind of says it all. It's a platform where you can donate money and they give the money directly through a mobile phone account to a person living in extreme poverty. They started in East Africa, but it's expanded now many places. And they've now given, I believe, something like $150 million away in large increments, about $1,000 per household, directly to the person who needs it. And then the people who get the money can tell you what they did with it. And you can see they have it live on a website, gdlive.com, I think, .org, where you can read about, you know, what people say about what they did with the money. It's a very different approach. Yes, it's a donation. Yes, it's philanthropy. But instead of looking at the person at the end of that chain as the victim, I think the new approach is to say that person is central to solving whatever challenge they face in their life. And we need to see them as a user or a customer, even if we're donating money to them. Give them a lot more autonomy and authority over what they do with the money. So just very quickly on this, because of the old way of thinking, when GiveDirectly got started, people said, well, that's a terrible idea, because if you give money to poor people in cash, they will spend it. They will spend it on alcohol, or they will spend it on other vices, and they will waste it. And GiveDirectly said, well, do we know this? Or is this just an idea? And so the people who started this were economists, and they set about doing some studies. And they said, let's try to donate some money directly to very poor people and see what they do with the money. And they found that those ideas that they would waste it weren't proved by the data, that people actually used it for productive things. They used it to feed their families, to get the clothes they need to go to work, to pay for the transportation they need to go to work, to fix up their house. They use it for really productive activities. So I think this mindset shift to a customer or a user or a neighbor or a partner is important, because it will actually get us to the results that we all want to see.
Thank you. Can I ask Vineet Sharma to unmute himself and come forward with his question? Vineet, you have the floor.
Yeah. I have a basic question regarding this, you know, redistribution challenges that we are seeing, you know, with the social media and the big tech, you know, because it is leading to, you know, a lot of rent seeking, you know, and crowding out of innovation and through, you know, exploiting the patents and, you know, and the and its monopoly power over the data and over its lobbying power with the political class, which is causing this lot of, you know, inequality into the system, you know. So how do you deal with that, you know, because that is the major challenge, because the way it is, you know, impacting the way our corporates are functioning, the way our political class is functioning, the way our society is emerging out of it. It is becoming a lot more, it is becoming grave challenge for the whole of the education system, health system to come in terms with it. So how do you deal with these redistribution challenge, because it is the monopolies are basically acquiring the small startups. The way the innovation and creativity used to happen 2 decades back is simply being stifled. So how do you come in with terms with that? How do you deconstruct that?
Well, it's a very difficult question, but it's something we all are experiencing, right? The world, especially with the digital revolution, we're in a winners take all kind of world. Like if you build the business that can have a network effect and can really grow quickly, you can quickly take over an entire market. And you see now that, you know, the businesses that started early in the internet revolution got huge, and they're taking over entire industries. In the United States, we have Amazon. They're of course all over the world, but they're equivalents to Amazon in many other countries in the world. Maybe you're in India. In India, they're equivalents. I think Flipkart maybe is an example of a kind of massive e-commerce platform there. So you see that the benefits start to accrue very quickly when you have these network effects, especially in technology-driven businesses. And that's exacerbating the income inequality, because if you can be one of the winners, if you can get to the top, maybe you went to an elite school and you were able to get into one of these businesses at the right time, and sort of the benefits to being elite, to being wealthy already, start to accrue, and they start to lock out everyone else. And so you end up with societies where there's very little social mobility, and that can occur in rich societies and in poor societies. So I don't think there's some easy solution to this. I think it's a pretty fundamental governance challenge that we face, where you need essentially governments to stand up and regulate appropriately these industries to avoid too much monopoly power. You need tax policy to be much smarter than it is now to address massive inequality. You want to keep innovation, of course. You want people to build businesses, but it doesn't have to be a world where you have 2,000 billionaires at the top and everyone else is sliding down the economic scale. There has to be another way to do this. But it does take some real political courage. And I think the realities of economic change and digital transformation are happening faster than governments and societies have been able to adapt. So this is a bigger issue than those of us who work in the aid industry, in NGOs and development and philanthropy. It's a bigger issue than we ourselves can tackle. It's a bit like when people talk about humanitarian challenges. You know, there's something an NGO can do or a UN agency can do to go solve the problem in the short run to provide food or medicine. But usually the reason there's a humanitarian challenge might be a political challenge. It might be a war or a conflict, and you need the world to come together to solve that. And I think we're dealing with something very similar here to what you're bringing up. This is a much larger global issue, and the values behind what we care about, if you work on the SDGs or social impact, we need those values reflected in systems of regulation and systems of taxation. I think that's going to be key to the kind of future we all want to see.
Thank you. I've got a question here from Karim Makhlouf. Raj, thinking back about when you first came up with the idea of DevEx and considering where it is now, what would you attribute its growth and impact? If you can think of maybe the top three factors.
Yeah, I think like a lot of businesses, the idea is important. You know, you need to have a vision for what you're trying to achieve, and that is important. But often much more important than just the idea, because usually if it's a good idea, many people have it. A big part of it is the execution. And I think that's where, if I had to think of where have we been able to succeed, it's been around execution. And why is that important? Well, when we got started, we were starting as a social enterprise before most people knew what that really was. We were targeting an industry that most people didn't even think was an industry, right? We had to say to people, we're working in the world of development, it's an industry. And they would say, what do you mean? We're talking about charities and nonprofits and UN agencies. It's not an industry. This is a mission-driven group of people doing important good work around the world. We said, yeah, but think of it from an economic standpoint, it's kind of like an industry. There's certain funders, they're funding certain kinds of projects. There's a group of people who work in this space. And so even thinking of an industry was hard. So the reason why I say execution is maybe the first, second, and third of the answers to that question is that it took a long time for us to find any success, right? We started out as a very small nonprofit, very small for-profit social enterprise based out of my apartment with a few early colleagues. We were working really hard for years, but not getting a lot of traction. And it wasn't until probably 6, 7, 8 years into the growth of our idea that people started to see our vision and respond to it and say, okay, we see what you're trying to achieve and do here. We see why it would be valuable to have independent journalism covering the work of these agencies. We see why it might be valuable to have an open marketplace for talent so that not just the people who happen to be friends with someone else get the jobs in this field, or why having an open marketplace for funding would be important. But it took several years to get there. So I think had we not had the commitment to stick through it and to keep trying to execute and pivot, but stay true to that original core vision, we may never have had the success we've had. So, you know, we're like an overnight success that took 20 years, right? And I think that's often the case for many organizations, nonprofits and for-profits in the social space that succeed is there isn't much overnight success. It does take a long time to refine your ideas and to get to the point where you're really serving people.
Was it also a case of the right idea at the right time? 20 years ago already, there was quite a shift in the way that development was being seen. And when we started talking about international civil society, international NGOs as development actors within their own right. Wasn't that part of the wave that you jumped in on?
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right, Richard. We, you know, NGOs were growing a lot then. They were becoming global. The market in general of development activity was becoming more globalized. You know, the way it used to be was that you had USAID in Washington and a cluster of organizations around it getting funding from them. You had DFID in the UK, and you had similar bilateral aid agencies in different countries around the world, and a cluster of for-profit consulting firms and nonprofit NGOs around them. And I think what started to change around the time we started DevEx was people started to see this as a global field. And these issues were cross-cutting and connected. And so some of those NGOs started expanding globally. Some of those companies started expanding. There were more partnerships among the major donors. More private philanthropy started to grow. And we started to see this as a more globalized sector. So yeah, I absolutely agree with you, Richard. The timing was important for the way we all saw this field. There were also some basic things, like when we first started, if you wanted to get a job in global development, you would say, you know, I remember the advice I got when I was in graduate school from professors and people who worked in this field. They said, go to Washington, D.C. and go to cocktail parties. That's how you get a job at the World Bank or in the UN or in an NGO. And I thought, really, this is how this works? You have to go to cocktail parties to network and meet people? And so we said, what if we just found the jobs, whatever ones we can find, and put them on a website? And that was an innovative idea in the year 2000, believe it or not. And so we got these jobs on a website and it started to work, where people who didn't have access before could see what was available, could even see the kinds of jobs that, that exist in our field and begin to apply. And today it's, you know, it's now the largest job board in our sector, in the industry. We have 1 million people have their profiles on DevEx, and they use this as a place to find jobs, to connect with other people. So, but at the time, I think just moving to some transparency around the way you get a job in this field was a really big step forward.
And of course, and now with the fact that even the World Bank and the UN will advertise jobs on DevEx when they need to, it's absolutely fascinating, because then you also see, as somebody who's worked in the business for a long period of time, how that business basically started reforming itself. And what you also did with this is that you lowered the distance between these traditional development institutions, whether it's the World Bank or the UN or USAID or DFID, and actually the other parts, so that people actually can move between the different parts of the business. It's really, really important, I think, for the quality of the work that has been done. But now you start getting involved in this whole issue of philanthropy and philanthropic organizations. Now, from my vantage point, which is basically the United Nations, they're not that easy to reach. They're not as accessible as international NGOs are. So how is this going to go moving forward? Is this a point where systems start disintegrating, or they start moving into different direction? Or do you see a point of conversion between all of these development actors coming up?
I think they are going to converge. I think that is happening already, but I think we're in a moment where we can shape this, where, you know, our voices can matter in how this goes forward. So, you know, we talk a lot about private philanthropy, but really there's just a few big ones that are the major player. Of course, the Gates Foundation, Bloomberg Foundation, Open Society Foundation. There's just a few that are massive. But I give one story in the book that maybe points to where we're headed. And it's about a young couple. Their names are Carrie Tuna and Dustin Moskowitz. They're based in Silicon Valley. They made a fortune in the Silicon Valley world. And they decided to give it all away. They're a young couple in their 30s, I think, now. And they are giving away today more money than the Rockefeller Foundation gives every year. And I project they will be bigger than the Ford Foundation, probably in a few years. And Rockefeller and Ford were the most iconic foundations of the last century. This young couple is going to be donating more, most likely, than those two foundations. They're already, I think, $350 million a year or so that they're giving. So there are 2,000 billionaires in the world. And partly this is a policy failure, right? That we have so much wealth concentrated at the top. But I can't help but think that wealth at the top does create an opportunity if it can be directed into positive philanthropy that can make a real difference. The danger is that some of it can go into whimsical philanthropy. Well, philanthropy that maybe is just designed to improve someone's reputation, but not connected to results. Or someone is excited about an idea or an issue, so they put a lot of funding behind it, but it really distorts the market. And they, instead of listening to the players who are already in the space and supporting what's working on the ground. So I think we need to shape it. But my expectation is there will be much more private philanthropy coming one way or the other. And that private philanthropy, if it's held accountable and if it's shaped toward results, can have enormous potential in helping us to achieve the SDGs. And I think ultimately it will have to be integrated with our sector. One of the possibilities that would be a sad reality and result is, you know, a lot of private philanthropy today goes to major wealthy universities or goes to major museums. And that kind of donation happens in part because you get your name on a building, you get to see, feel some legacy, you know, you named a university chair. And there's nothing wrong with that per se, but when you look at the real problems in the world where money should be directed on issues like hunger and health and basic education, there's huge need and comparatively very little private philanthropy going there. So we need to somehow push the new wave of private philanthropy into these areas of dramatic need and hold it accountable against results.
Raj, before I cut back to two questions that we've got hanging, the issue of that accountability, you've come back to it now twice. And when I was preparing for this, I was looking around at different people who actually disagreed with you. And one person who disagreed with you, and it's always important that we recognize it also. One person said, why should the gravest problems of our days be solved by unelected upper crust overachievers? Now that was very nicely written, so I decided to quote it in full. But the concept, of course, behind this is, however much I respect Bill Gates and Melinda Gates, they really represent somebody, or how can you actually bring them into a system that will hold them accountable?
Yeah, it's a fair point. And I think even people who work at the Gates Foundation feel similarly that there's this issue around legitimacy. And so they're sensitive to it. In fact, there's been a lot of reporting, including from us recently, you know, the Gates Foundation is the second largest donor to the World Health Organization. So my guess is whoever that critic is probably thinks the World Health Organization is a good thing, that we need a global body like that. And it should be representative. You know, they have 193 member states or something on the board of the WHO. Challenge is, how do you get the best of a global legitimate organization that can hear from governments, elected and unelected, and get the best innovation that can come from private philanthropy? Now, it's not such an easy thing to solve. The Gates Foundation has done enormous, really important and good work. I think the world is better off for having it than not. The question though is, let's say it was someone different than Bill and Melinda Gates, and we didn't really agree with their politics. Maybe they were trying to fund things in a very different way. They had a very ideological view, perhaps. You know, we have the example of Bill and Melinda, who've done, I think, a lot of really important and good work, but we don't yet have this highly negative example, at least not at this scale. But let's imagine we had such an example. I think we would want to start thinking about a regulatory framework around philanthropy to ensure that it is targeted in the right way. So the kinds of things we could think about is, you know, does the government provide tax incentives? Like in the United States, if you give away money, you get a tax deduction. Okay, well, in exchange for that, what does the government require? And in the US, the requirements are very limited. So you do have to report a form that shows sort of what you've given the money to, but you could choose to put your foundation in a private company, in an LLC, as it's called, limited liability company. That's, for example, what the Mark Zuckerberg and Priscilla Chan have done with Chan Zuckerberg Initiative. And the advantage for them of doing this is they don't have to be transparent at all. They don't have to publish public reports about what they've done with the money. But I think we might need to look at the regulatory framework here and say, to get the tax deductions that you want to see, you have to be much more transparent about what you've spent the money on. And that way, even though you don't have public legitimacy, you know, being elected, these are unelected wealthy people, at least the public can see what you've done with the money. Hmm. And the public can say, hey, we don't agree with the direction that foundation is going, and speak up. The media can cover you. And maybe eventually governments can regulate you if they find that you're really doing things that are against the public interest. But I think the first thing is transparency. And we just don't have anywhere near enough basic transparency today in the philanthropy sector.
Thank you. Let me go over to one of the questions. Now, this is somebody who correct or nicely starts off. I do not know if I'm allowed to ask any questions, but I will try. Obviously, you can
I'm
ask
glad
questions.
They are.
Exactly. Is the problem inequity itself, or is the only problem a limit of social mobility? If we had acceptable social mobility, would inequality still be an undesirable phenomenon? Is there a social gap that would be too large to be accepted, even if it happened in a fairly competitive society?
It's an interesting kind of philosophical question. And my guess is it depends on the society. You know, I think probably some societies would tolerate more of a gap than others. To me, what's most important right now at this moment in human history is not necessarily the gap between the richest and the poorest. That does matter, certainly. But to me, what's even more important is the basic floor. You know, at what level is the poorest person in the world living? And how do we raise that basic floor up? Again, it's a separate issue. It's connected in some ways. And it doesn't, and this is not me saying that inequality is unimportant, not at all. But like when I was born, you know, I'm in my 40s, when I was born, it was about 4 in 10 people in the world who lived in extreme poverty. It's now about 1 in 10. Because of the pandemic, it's gotten a bit worse for the first time in a couple of decades. And we're, you know, somewhere near 1 billion people, perhaps, that are in extreme poverty. Extreme poverty is $1.90 per day, according to the World Bank PPP. Basically, it's so little money that you're living day to day, unsure what's going to happen the next day. You know, this is not a level of subsistence that we should permit socially in the world. We should say this is not acceptable to us. Every person in the world should have a basic level of income and consumption capability. They should have basic healthcare. You know, half the world does not have access to essential medicine, basic healthcare, according to the WHO. They should have access to basic education, right? So I think we need to raise the bottom, raise the standard of what we consider acceptable in an era when we've got, you know, missions to Mars and we have incredible technology, incredible wealth. We need to change sort of the frame around what we tolerate as a species around extreme poverty, I think. And then this question that's being asked about, well, you know, if there's extreme social mobility, how much of a gap can we tolerate? I think that's more of a question maybe within a country or within a society. You could debate what is the appropriate level of inequality. There'll always be some inequality, of course. Today, it's very extreme globally and within many societies. It's very extreme. It's hard to argue that it's at the right end of whatever the spectrum is. It's even many people are at the very high end say inequality is a big problem and we need to address it. So I think my answer to it would be, it's an important question. It's an interesting question, but I would look more at the bottom. What is the floor and how do we raise that? Even this $1.90 a day, just the last point on this, is a totally arbitrary figure. It's not based on some science, right? This is just a kind of based on tradition. A number of countries have, you know, looked at the map of the economic map of their country and said, well, we think this is about the poverty line. And the World Bank has taken that together and said, that's the poverty line, but it's totally arbitrary. And something like 70% of the world today lives on less than $10 a day. So, you know, I think let's focus a lot on the floor in terms of income and education and health services, and then think about inequality from that perspective.
Next question is from Gada Nadi. She writes, how do you see the for-profit organizations working in the development industry versus non-profit ones, whether national or international? Is there any evidence that one model yields better outcome and achieves the desired results better than any other?
I haven't seen evidence that would suggest that. And the way I like to think about it is it's not so much about making a profit or not making a profit. It's more about the market mechanism that you're using. So you can be a nonprofit, but have a market mechanism in your model so that you're really listening to your end customer and whether or not they like your service or find it useful, they vote maybe with their own money to decide how well you're doing. So, you know, when I talk about kind of business models in our field, that's what I'm referring to. Not necessarily whether you, for tax purposes, show a profit or not. There are nonprofits where, you know, the executive team earns lots of money. It's not counted as profits. It's just a salary. And there are for-profits that maybe make very little money or lose money. So I'm not sure that is the operative issue. And I don't think there is evidence around the question you're asking. I think the operative issue is what is the mechanism that we're using to achieve the result we want to achieve? And then can we measure ourselves against that? To me, that's much more important than whether we designate something as not-for-profit or for-profit. Now, there is certainly a difference, especially at the ends of a spectrum, between a very mission-oriented organization and one that has no mission other than making money. And that's true. But increasingly, there are many organizations in the middle of that spectrum where they say, okay, we want to make a profit because that's part of our sustainability model, but we also have a mission that we measure. And so we're trying to do those two things together. And the World Economic Forum calls us the fourth sector. And I think there's huge potential there because I think this is where a lot of younger generations see themselves, that they like some of the business model approaches you see in private companies. They don't like the excesses, the pollution, the inequality. So they want the mission and they want the model around a business. They want those two things married together. And I don't think there's a reason we can't do that.
Does it then mean that you see that the big wave of the future is going to be impact investment? It's going to be enterprises with a social benefit? I mean, the counter argument to that has often been given by my brother-in-law, the big business tycoon. The big business tycoon basically means if you want to have sustainability in the world, make it profitable and we will solve the problem for you. These are two different paradigms to look at, right? One that basically says, give carbon a price and we will manage it from the corporate sector. And another one that says, well, essentially, if you want to have a sustainable world, you need to change business models of the for-profits in a very substantive, in a very fundamental way. How do you see this?
Yeah, I see huge promise in some big companies changing and in many small startups, young social enterprises and social entrepreneurs. I just don't think it's enough. And I do think it's still very easy to do greenwashing or what they call rainbow washing, you know, to talk a lot about the SDGs, but not necessarily be changing your business approach sufficiently to address them. So I think you're raising a fair and valid point, and it kind of connects to my point about philanthropy, that we need more accountability in this space. You know, you as a private citizen can say, I want to invest in an impact investing fund or some kind of an ESG fund, environmental social governance fund. And when you look inside those funds, you might be surprised of what it's actually investing in. A lot of it might not seem like some very positive business. Again, depending on the fund and how it's structured, there might be funding companies that sort of hurt human health. Maybe they produce junk food or tobacco even. So I think it's important to look a little below the layer of the label impact and the label ESG and to start to really measure what is that impact and to have stricter accountability around this. But I think we're moving in that direction. I see real promise heading in this direction. And I don't see an alternative to it really. You know, you obviously one person might say, well, let's just have government regulate so strongly that you can, you know, completely clamp down on the negative externalities of businesses. And I think there's a big role for government regulation, especially on climate. But it's probably unlikely that you're going to solve it entirely from that. And then you're missing the opportunity of all the young people and the consumers who are pushing businesses to say, I want you to operate more responsibly. I want you to innovate even in these directions. So I think there we can hit it from both sides. I see that. I think there's huge potential here. And yes, I think in the future, most big businesses will have some kind of a social mission attached to them and will be held much more accountable by their investors, their employees, and their customers.
A question from Ragda El Megli. Aside from the job listings, what resources are available on DevEx to help people, and I would assume that means young people, to get resources and to succeed in development jobs?
Yeah, well, we have a whole number of resources like this, and they're actually not, Richard, just for young people. They're for people of all ages, because we have a lot of people who transition from a career, let's say, in the private sector, and they want to move, you know, into the public or the development sector in some way. So we have you can go to our website, devx.com. There's something called a career center there. You can see it when you click into jobs. And we have webinars, we have articles, we have videos, lots of content, everything from how to write your resume, your CV, to how to apply for a job, to what are the different kinds of development jobs, probably even more content than you can consume. But hopefully you'll find exactly what you need to get into a career here and to maybe advance your career. Some of that content costs money. Some of it's behind our paywall, where we have paid memberships. That's part of our business model as a social enterprise, but a lot of it's free. And many universities pay for subscription access to it so that their students and their alumni get access to it as well. So do check it out and don't hesitate to reach out to me directly on Twitter if there's questions you got or ways we can do better. The big part of our mission is helping people to advance their career in the social impact sector.
Another question, I think this one comes from Ali. The majority of local giving happens from the many regular citizens and not the few billionaires. How do we provide a platform to allow the many regular citizens to give globally?
Yeah, you know, there are platforms like this. I mean, one is Global Giving. I talk about it in my book. And the basic idea there is they showcase smaller scale projects and initiatives that might need to raise a few $1,000s. And then anyone who has access to the internet and maybe a credit card or I'm not sure, PayPal, they can go in there and donate money directly to those smaller projects. There's Kiva, which takes loans of as little as $25. You can make a loan in a small micro enterprise somewhere in the world. So I think there's a lot of platforms like this. And I do talk about quite a bit in the book, this idea of crowdfunding and how it's opening up and people can donate through their cell phone, you know, sending a text message when there's a crisis or an emergency. So I think there's huge potential in this crowdfunding space. It does all come back to the same point around results, right? Because there have been many cases around crowdfunding. I talk about one in the book after the earthquake in Haiti, the American Red Cross raised something like $500 million, but then they were criticized that it was mainly to build houses, to provide housing to people who lost their homes during the Haitian earthquake, but very few homes were actually built. And so people who donated small amounts of money through their cell phone, they felt frustrated about what the result that they got. So I think we need to increasingly get to this accountability around what you're funding. And imagine if you as a consumer, in the same way you buy a product online and you can see a rating and see what other customers think about it and, you know, did the product work? If you could similarly donate and see, hey, did this thing I donated to, did it actually help? Did the people it was meaning to help, did they say it was useful to them? And if there was some numeric and quantitative ways to measure these results, I think it would spur more people to give and maybe to give even more, even larger amounts if they felt they could directly engage in solving some of the biggest challenges in the world. I think it would be an incredibly satisfying feeling for average people, and they might start giving much more than they do now.
Thank you, Raj. We're getting to the end of what has been an incredibly exciting session. And now I want to just be a little bit parochial. In your most recent article, 7 Predictions for 2021, which I can highly recommend to anybody who's in development to take a good look at, you're actually talking about the slide in sustainable development goals. And it, of course, we all know education has been seriously affected. Health indicators have been seriously affected. Women have been pushed out of the labor market globally. There's a serious problem coming up globally again, violence against women. On the other side, on the ecological side, on the climate change side, actually there have been some beneficial effects of people working at home. But by and large, that slide is a reality. Does that herald now the end of a concept like sustainable development goals? Is there time for something new to come up that can play a bigger integrative role?
I don't think it's the end of the SDGs. I think it just makes them more important. And it's true, we are way behind. But let's say we never had the pandemic. We probably would not have hit the SDGs anyway if we stayed on our current trajectory, right? We needed some kind of a shift in the way we're working to get there. You know, the world before the pandemic was already extremely unequal and getting less equal. We were already seeing a slide in democracies and human rights, right? We were seeing a number of these challenges before the pandemic hit. So the pandemic, yes, has made it much worse in the short run. It's created a lot of additional problems. But either way, to get to a more equal, a more just world, to address climate change, we've got to do something different. We can't just keep doing business as usual. And we have a lot of the tools. A lot of them are there. A lot of them are embedded in the sustainable development goals. You can, you know, the goals are very detailed in terms of how they think about every issue from oceans to gender to hunger. It's a question of doing and finding these innovations and scaling them. So yeah, I don't think it's that they're less important just because we're further away from achieving the goals. I think the goals are as relevant and essential as they always were. And what I'm looking for and listening for a lot are big ideas for how we get there. Like, I think coming out of something like this pandemic, I would hope this really tough experience, all these people who have died, all these economies that have slid, that world leaders would say, okay, we can't do business as usual. We need to do something else. And you know, that doesn't just mean donating large amounts of money. Okay, that's probably part of it. That probably has to be part of it. But also just another way of thinking about these problems and pulling the entire world together into solving them. I think we've got to use this moment to do that. And I'm not seeing much yet that gives me confidence that that's the direction we're going in, but I do believe that's what's required.
I have to unmute myself. Thank you. Thank you very, very, very much. Now, we have all been chasing you with many, many questions, and maybe at the end of the line, you think, there is something that I should say to everybody that I've forgotten so far. So I would like to give you the opportunity for the final word.
Yeah, well, I'm happy to give a few more final thoughts. And I just want to say thank you, first of all, to you, Richard, to Ali, and to everybody who's been part of the conversation today. Great questions. And truly, I don't have the answers. You know, I hopefully you see that in the way I'm trying to address them, that I wrote this book in part to spark a conversation and to spark that conversation, because I think actually we have more power than we may realize as a global development industry, an aid industry, as NGO leaders and others. We actually have power to shape this future. I think very often we think of ourselves as a small sector, and we're kind of waiting to see what political leaders do or what, you know, billionaire philanthropists do. But the truth is, this is a $200 billion industry. There are millions of professionals around the world who work in it. I include in it, in my conception of it, UN agencies, bilateral aid agencies, major NGOs and foundations. You know, as a group, as a collective, if we change the way we think about achieving something like the SDGs, we can actually make real impact. And really, there's no one else besides this industry that's charged with this. Like, really, this is the heart of achieving those SDGs and addressing the climate. So I guess my call to all of you is thinking about these questions. Maybe there are no easy answers. Maybe there's no obvious, simple solution. But don't let that make you think there's no way to get there. There's no way to make progress. I think we know many of the things that work, and we need to push for them. You know, this is a one of the points I make in the book that's probably obvious to most of you from your own work is that poverty is not just about not having enough money. Poverty is fundamentally an issue of justice. And it's usually the people in a society who have the least voice, right, who are the most marginalized. They tend to be the poorest people because it's not just about not having money. So we need to really build that more just world. And we have a lot of levers at our disposal. We have levers as a consumer, where you buy from, who you buy from, as an employee, you know, are you pushing the place that you work to have the right policies? You have levers for as an investor, where you put your money, your pension plan, what you want to dedicate your funds to. We have a lot of levers. And I think if we can use the SDGs for what they are, which is a fundamental framework about where we want to go, and then try to innovate our way there using these business models. I talk about these market mechanisms, finding examples of what works, lifting those up and doing more of them. I think there's real potential, and it really is on all of our shoulders to do it. So I hope in writing this book and having this kind of conversation, which I've been doing lots of these in the last year or so, I really just hope to spark that discussion and get us thinking and hopefully get us moving in that direction.
Thank you, Raj. Your final comment actually reminds me of a very smart statement by Rabindranath Tagore, the great poet laureate, who says, some politicians seem to think that in order to light up a house, you need to set it afire. But a candle in each room works much better. Be that candle. And I think that you are not just a candle, you're a torch for development. And I would like to thank you tremendously for this tour de force that you have shown us. It was an enormous pleasure to dive into your thinking and your world. And I know that our students and the audience has greatly benefited from this. I would like to thank, of course, Ali Auni for his contribution and bringing this all together. Again, Raj Kumar, thank you. And I would like to ask the audience, tune in next week, Tuesday, where we are moving from this week, an alumnus of Harvard Kennedy School, to next week an alumnus from Cornell University, Mr. Christopher Marquis, who will be talking to us about remaking capitalism. Thank you again, everybody, and hope to see you soon in person or otherwise meet you in one of these great webinars. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Richard. Thanks, everyone.
Cheers.
Thank you.